Yep. Anyway.
Camera speeds. Sound speeds.
Sorry, whatever. Oh, we're filming? How embarrassing. Wow, there was just a huge thudding knock on our door, which was quite frightening, but nothing is gonna get in the way of dongs. What is it? Oh, I'm not recording on my screen. Well, let's check out Wikipedia. Okay, we've got Dong Lake, pretty good. We've got the Dong people, Queen Dong, the Dong language. Oh, but what's this? Dong, a segment of the Vsauce YouTube channel. Guys, we made it. We made it. Which brings me to interactive polyhedra. I love interacting with polyhedra. I'd probably say the icosahedron is my 17th favorite. It has 20 sides and what a beaut. It's a platonic solid, meaning every single one of its faces is a regular polygon, an equilateral triangle in this case, and every corner is the same. Look at this corner. It's the meeting of 5 equilateral triangles. Great, what about this corner? 5 triangles. This corner, 5 triangles. It's a platonic solid, guys, and I love it. But sometimes, even a platonic solid needs to get cut. I'm talking truncation, where the corners are cut off. Now, what would happen if I cut off a corner, if I just sliced right through with a plane, on an icosahedron? Well, let's take a look. All right, so we'd cut right through here. That would leave us with a face that is 5 sided, a pentagon. But then the faces as they are right now, which are triangles, would receive 3 new sides. So they would have 6, making them hexagons. Pentagons and hexagons on the same solid? That is a truncated icosahedron, AKA a soccer ball. Pretty, pretty cool. Of course, David McCooey's Visual Polyhedra Encyclopedia is way, way more extensive than the sites I just showed, but we have shown this on a dong before. What we haven't shown is the proper way to have a mathematical breakfast, which brings me to George Hart and a technique to cut a bagel so that you're left with 2 completely separate but interlocked rings. That's right, these 2 bagel rings have not been cut and glued back together. This was 1 bagel, and you could do this yourself in the morning. This entire site is incredibly informative. You can learn all about how to make the proper cut to cut your bagel in 2 pieces that are interlocked. How delicious. Now, of course, you can cut bagels in any way that you want in the morning. Your life is your life. But if you don't cut them like this, you're a loser. Okay, next we've got Stranger Things. This site allows you to upload any image that you want, and then its AI will try to understand what's in the photo. It will then create a Stranger Things styled poster using that image. The posters pretty much all look the same, but what it does is it replaces the word things with what it thinks your image is a picture of. I'll show you what I'm talking about. You click the TV to upload a picture, and I will try. How about that picture of a light bulb that we took last time? Okay, now it's gonna process, and stranger lighting. Not bad, right? And then here's the bulb in the poster. Let's go again. I'm gonna try something a little tougher. I'm gonna try this picture that Draw with Jazza on YouTube made of me as a supervillain. I'm gonna open that one. And stranger green. Vsauce 1 is green in its theme. That's pretty good, but I'm not done yet. What I really wanna try is this picture right here. It's a napkin ring, and I wonder if it knows what a napkin ring is. Stranger red. All right, let me just say this. I think that if it doesn't have any clue what the image is, it just mentions the color that it is. I'll give it one more chance. I'll upload this photo of me from Brain Candy Live, where I'm covered in smoke. Stranger facial hair. That's pretty good. And the poster looks cool. Look at how my face is just emerging from the storm clouds. All right. Ooh, the Stroop test. All right, great. So I love the Stroop test. It's a classic in psychology. In the Stroop test, you see words that you can read, and those words are printed in a color. Now your challenge is to, in this game here, report the color that the word is printed in, not what the word actually says. And it's pretty interesting how difficult this is to do. There are a lot of theories about why it's so difficult. One is that reading and understanding, comprehending written words is more automatic. That when we see a word, because we're so used to it, it's habitual, we automatically create a meaning in our mind from that word. But we don't use color that way. When I look around the world, I think of maybe what the objects are, but I don't automatically, involuntarily think about what colors I'm looking at. Now, some people are better at this than others. But as it turns out, the word, actually reading what the word says, has this kind of automatic primacy that takes away from the finite amount of attention you have to pay towards things like saying what color the word is printed in. Let's see how I do. Play, blue, it's written in yellow though. Good, got that, blue, yellow, pink, yellow, blue, black, blue. Whew. Next level, I'm ready. Pink, no, now they move. Yellow, red, blue. Ah, I hit black, but that was just a mistake from the clicking. Try the level again, yeah. You know what, I'm gonna try not saying any words because I think that might give me an advantage. Oh, this is really getting harder. Man, wow, with this changing background, I'm really focused on what the word means, not what color it's written in. And now there's cats, right, okay. I think the cats are easier than the flashing background. I'm gonna go one more level. Oh. Okay. You win. I defeated all the distractions in 70.2 seconds. Can you do better? Probably. Next. General Relativity, the comic? Yeah, this is a pretty cool way to read about how Einstein thought about the world and the thought experiments he used to understand what became his theory of general relativity. You just scroll down and read all of the things that are going on. It's very neat. I really, really like it, and I highly recommend it. So it's really all I have to say. I don't want to do any spoilers, but check that out. It's sciencemag.org's general relativity site. Okay, two more things. Colorado's FET website is phenomenal, and we've covered this before, but this one relates to my newest video and or my next video, depending on how soon I get that done. This might come out before then, doesn't really matter. The point is pendulums. I love that here I can actually raise up a pendulum. I'm gonna put it all the way up at 90 degrees, and I can let it go, and I can see how it swings. Now, right now there's no friction, but watch what happens if I have a mass way up here, and then I introduce a second mass that I will give the same mass to, 1 kilogram. I'll raise it up, and notice that mass 2 is further away from the pivot point. It should fall more slowly, and it does. Why even interact with the real world when you can do all the same stuff on a computer? Finally, big shout out to Brilliant.org, our sponsor for this episode. It's fantastic. I'm gonna play through some of these right now. The great thing about Brilliant.org is that you can choose anything you want. It doesn't even have to be math. You know what, I'm gonna do science. Gravitational physics, that's pretty related to my last video. Ooh, should we do Newtonian gravity? I think we should. Here we go, escape velocity. What Brilliant.org does is present you with challenging puzzles that you then have to answer, and by answering them, whether you're right or wrong, you learn a whole bunch of stuff. So, let's do an introduction to gravity. Mass dependence, yeah, everyone loves mass. Newton studies an apple in his hand. He estimates that the mass of the apple is about 10% of the mass of his head. How do the following gravitational forces compare? We have the force that the Earth applies to Newton's head and the force that the Earth applies to the apple. Ah, perfect. So, the force of the Earth on his head is about 10 times that of the apple, which is this one, E to the head. Correct. Whew, got it right. I started a one-day streak. All right, next, What about the force Newton's head applies to the Earth? Well, that is also going to be 10 times more than what the apple applies to Earth. Correct. Now they're just kind of floating in space, I think. The force that his head exerts on the apple and the force the apple exerts on his head. Guess what, guys? Those are even, Steven. Correct. Only 52% of people got this right. Guess they didn't watch my last video, am I right? Smash that subscribe button over on Vsauce1 to learn more. Continue. Mass dependence. Okay, the last series of questions shows us that the form of Newton's universal force law needs to be linear in each mass, symmetric in the masses. Which of these choices is a possible mass dependence of the law? Well, I already know that it's multiplication. Genius alert! Okay, now, finish quiz. Quiz complete? I completed 4 problems and got 4 correct. Guess I'm done. Just kidding, I'm not. Go to brilliant.org/dong to continue your educational journey in your life. And as always, thanks for watching.